Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inna alhamdulillah. الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا وأنزل كتابه وجعله حكما عربيا وعلم القرآن وخلق الإنسان وعلمه البيان له الحمد في الأولى والآخرة وله الحكم وإليه ترجعون وصلى اللهم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وَمَنْ تَبِيَهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ إِلَى يَوْمِ الدِّينِ ثُمَّ أَمَّا بَعْدُ. My dear respected brothers and sisters, in the wake of Paris, San Bernardino, Mali, and other places that have seen the evil acts of terrorism, I thought it was appropriate for us to have a discussion, to ask a question. Is Daesh and other such violent Islamic groups, I mean, violent extremist groups, they're not Islamic, are they Islamic? Because you see, the media is jumping on that narrative to say that ISIS, ISIL, Boko Haram, all of these, they are in fact Islamic. That's why they choose the term violent Islamist terrorists, such a long term. They're going to start adding a fourth and a fifth word to it to try to define this. Radical Islamists, whatever. They use the term Islam in their derogatory terms, so that way it leaves a subliminal message to the recipient that it's all Islam. So let's ask that question then. Are these groups Islamic in what it is that they're doing and what it is that they're preaching? Because if we don't answer that question, we're allowing them to define Islam in the media. And the media is not your friend, by the way. The media's job is to get ratings. It's to get more people to come to their website or their channel. It's to sell ads. So the more sensational the news, the more ratings they get. There's a business behind it, and also propaganda. My dear respected brothers and sisters, I think it is high time that we get to discuss the very same verses which ISIS, ISIL, all of them, they use to commit acts of aggression, injustice, tyranny, you name it, anarchy. Because the reason why, brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Al-Quran. Do you know where Al-Quran came from? Subhanallah. Listen to the genesis of Qur'an. This book we have, Al-Qur'an today, all the words in it, where did they originate from? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is quoted in a hadith by Imam At-Tirmidhi saying this. And he was speaking about the pen, since Allah revealed a surah about the pen. Does any of the young minds here know which surah talks about the pen? No coaching, you have to raise your hand. There's a surah that talks about the pen. Only the young minds first. Because you see, the target of ISIS propaganda are the youth. That is their goal. Young minds that are forming. Young minds that don't have yet information so that they can brainwash and shape them and make them join them. They're not looking for you, the elderly. Your minds have been formed, you have bad habits already, they don't like you anymore. Besides, you're gonna just warn them not to do what it is they're doing, so they don't need you. They need young minds that will just follow. This surah you will find in Juz Tabarak. That's the hint, yes. Allahu Akbar. How old are you? He says, I'm 13 years old, and he was able to identify the surah. We should have a Quran study class, by the way, here, where we just explore Quran. You'll find it's the most wonderful thing. He says, no, Surah Al-Qalam. By the way, Mufassirin say that probably it is the second surah that was revealed. You know, they place it second or third. Because the first surah is Alaq, right? Iqra, right? You see, you want to say, wait a minute, if the first surah is Iqra, how come the next surah after Iqra is not second? What's the surah after Iqra? Allahu Akbar. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. So, but what you see there is the recitational order, how it was recited in order. However, the revelational order of the surahs matter. Which one was revealed first, next? Not perfectly, because ayat came down, not entire surahs necessarily. Okay, qalam. In it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'udhu min ash-shaytani rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Noon. Wal-qalami wa ma yasturun. Allah gave us a letter. The first letter to be mentioned in Quran, Huruf al-Muqatta'at, the disjointed letters. Noon is the first. Allahu Akbar. We don't know what noon indicates right there in that spot. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never explained what the noon is doing there. It's not a word, it's a letter only. And Allah says, swears, وَالْقَلَمِ وَمَا يَسْطُرُونَ. And by the pen and what they inscribe. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said in a hadith by a Tirmidhi, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الْقَلَمُ فَقَالَ لَهُ اُكْتُبُ. He said, the first thing that Allah created was the pen. And he said to the pen, write. فَقَالَ الْقَلَمْ يَا رَبِّي وَمَا أَكْتُبُ. The pen said, my Lord, what should I write? Allah said, اُكْتُبْ الْقَدَرُ. Write the qadr, write the decree of things. وَمَا هُوَ كَائِنٌ إِلَى الْأَبَدِ. And everything that will happen till the end of time. So the pen was instructed to write from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all things decreed. When things will happen, what will happen, from the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows how everything will happen. Because He's Al-Alim. He is the All-Knowing. He's omniscient. Now, this record that this pen wrote, Allah refers to it in Quran by a name. Sometimes referred to as Al-Lawhi Mahfuz, the preserved tablet. Or sometimes Allah calls it Ummul Kitab, the mother book. Okay? So Allah says about the Quran, in Surah Al-Buruj, in the end, Allah says, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَجِيدٌ فِي لَوْحِ مَحْفُوظٍ. That this Quran, this majestic book, is where? اللَّوْحِ مَحْفُوظٍ. That is why you see ayat of the Akhirah in linguistics referred to in the past tense. Allah has seen how everything happens. Let me give you an example. How an ayah that speaks of the future is in the past tense. Isn't that amazing? Something that hasn't even happened yet from our perspective, Allah talks about it in past tense. Not it will happen, Allah said it happened. In Al-Ma'idah, Allah says, وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى. Somebody who knows Arabic will tell me, وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ. What does that say in literal translation? وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ. Yes. Remember when Allah said. That's the future. Why do we know it's a future? وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى ابْنَ مَرْيَمَ أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّيَ إِلَيْهَيْنِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ. Allah is asking Isa a question, يوم القيامة, and Allah says, remember when Allah said. Allah has seen exactly how things will happen. Allah chose from Al-Lawhi Mahfuz the information that you see in the Quran al-Kareem. That this is from the knowledge of Allah. This Quran, how did it come to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? See, sometimes, even Quraysh, they ask this question. لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الْقُرْآنُ جُمْلَةً وَاحِدًا. Why doesn't it just come like once? And look, you know, just drop it on him. They think that it's just a book. Now, granted, Allah revealed a Torah to Musa alayhi salam all at once, not in stages. When Quraysh asked this question, why does it all come at once? Allah gave them an answer. كَذَلِكَ لِنُثَبِّتَ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَرَتَّلْنَاهُ تَرْتِيلًا وَلَا يَأْتُونَ بِمَثَلٍ إِلَّا جِئْنَاكَ بِالْحَقِّ وَأَحْسَنَ تَفْسِيرًا. Allah's response is just eloquent. Well, of course, Allah is the source of language. Allah says, I'm revealing it piece by piece so that way it will strengthen the heart of the messenger. So that way the Qur'an will empower him. So that way the Qur'an will be received gradually by people. So that way it is understood. It is applied. Now, how does the Qur'an come? We recite it from Surah Al-Qiyamah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that when the Qur'an used to come, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was so keen to not forget it. When Jibreel is reciting it, he's reciting along and he's moving his tongue very quickly. Allah said to him, لَا تُحَرِّكْ بِهِ لِسَانَكَ لِتَعْجَلَ بِهِ. Don't move your tongue quickly to just rush. You know, today a young child will memorize the Qur'an before they're 10 years old, right? They will memorize dozens of surah in a month, right? Allah says, Qur'an, you have to internalize it. The objective is not just to memorize. Is to understand what you're memorizing and to act upon it. So Allah tells the Prophet this, don't rush. This is how we will put it in your heart. Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana. Allah says, we bring in these pieces of ayat, we will combine them in your heart. We will put it together in your heart. Because Allah is revealing ayah by ayah sometimes. But then today an ayah of one surah comes, tomorrow an ayah of another surah comes. How do you piece it together? Can a human being, put together Al-Quran if you were to take it and divide it into each individual ayah, mix it up in a big ball, and then have any human being today who has not memorized the Quran put it together? Those who memorize, they will have a very difficult time. Because every hafid has forgotten something. No, it is humanly impossible. It is a work of human genius if we say Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made up this Quran when he said the statements in 23 years. Can anybody give me one paragraph of something you said last week? One paragraph. Just think, a paragraph of something you said to somebody, do you remember? A paragraph of something you said last night, forget about it. Can somebody give me a paragraph of what I just said right now in 13 minutes? You cannot say what I just said verbatim, right? Word for word. Impossible. That is why Allah said, "Inna alayna jam'ahu wa Qur'ana." Allah said, it is my responsibility to put it together in your heart. فَإِذَا قَرَأْنَاهُ فَاتَّبِعْ قُرْآنَ. And also we recite the Qur'an to you. That it's not just any book you just read the way you want to read. You have to read it the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it read. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard it from the lips of Jibreel. Can you imagine hearing Jibreel recite Qur'an, by the way? And then Allah says, after we bring it together in your heart, you listen to the recitation, and then you follow it, ثُمَّ إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا بَيَانًا. Then it's up to us to explain what Qur'an means. Which goes to show you that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam implemented everything Allah wanted him to implement from Qur'an. Nothing left out. He did it the way Allah wanted him to. It's very important for you and I to have that understanding. Which goes to show, if you want to judge how a person follows Quran, what should be your reference? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You just have to look at what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did in a similar circumstance, then you know if a person is following Quran or not. Because the notion that ISIS is Islamic is a false notion. But some people are trying to use it so they can say all Muslims are bad. To stoke fear and animosity. To start discrimination. that will ultimately lead to things like fascism and Nazism. We haven't forgotten Nazis. You hear people come on TV talk like they're Hitler. Very shameful. The values of this country completely reject and repudiate that. We fought against fascism and Nazism, and we defeated them before. We will defeat anybody who comes on TV, talks about Muslims like they are a Nazi. But let's answer the question again. Are they Islamic? Let's see how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam implemented the Quran. Something you will notice from what happened in San Bernardino and other places, Paris, that these criminals in Islam, they are very criminal. We should repudiate and speak against their acts always. They're un-Islamic, and I'm here to show you why they're un-Islamic, inshallah, because Allah has revealed why they are un-Islamic and they're treated as criminals in Islam. They target random people. People having dinner, people minding their business, people walking around. They target indiscriminately and then they kill people. Okay. Why do they do this? We're waiting for them to give us one ayah, maybe. They can say an ayah that if you misunderstood the ayah, it would give you that. See, so I'm even giving them leeway here to say, give me an ayah that could be misunderstood. Anyone, give me an ayah. If you misunderstand the ayah, it will lead you to kill an innocent person. Okay, so but that is part of an ayah. She's right. Eh? See, they love the small piece of the ayah. Yes, you see? These are the things, they pick clauses from the ayah. That's it. Kill them where you find it. That means we have to ask, who is them when Allah says, okay? Okay, so this is how they play. They play with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Before I even delve into this ayat, mashallah, you pick two of them. Allah gave us a warning about that in Quran. Allah warned us that you cannot take one piece of Quran or one piece of any scripture you live by, but you reject the other piece. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah said, أَفَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ. Do you believe in part of the book and you reject the other part of the book? What's the penalty for that? فَمَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ يَفْعَلُ ذَلِكَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا خِزْيٌ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. Whoever does this, Allah says, I will disgrace you in this dunya. وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يُرَدُّونَ إِلَىٰ أَشَدِّ الْعَذَابِ. Allah says, I have a more severe punishment waiting for you, يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Because they take one piece of a verse. They reject the entire Quran and they apply just this small piece. وَاقْتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثُ ثَقِفْتُمُوهُمْ. Okay. Rewind. وَاقْتُلُوهُمْ حَيْثُ ثَقِفْتُمُوهُمْ. Surah Al-Baqarah, Ayah 191. Rewind. One ayah before. Allah says, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ. وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُعْتَدِينَ. Allah says, only fight who? وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ. Those who are engaged in fighting you directly. So imagine somebody sitting in a movie theater or rock concert or having a dinner, watching soccer, are they fighting anybody? No. It's pretty clear from the ayah that the part of the ayah they're using, those people are not combatants, right? And yet they use that. So their claim of following Quran is purely false. In fact, they do it which Allah has warned, if you do that, you will be punished for it. They actually know they're doing that. They actually know that they pick and choose which ayat they implement and which ones they reject. Now, here's another challenge. If they know that it is wrong to kill an innocent person, don't you think they look for justification for killing innocent people? What do you think they use as justification for killing an innocent person? Someone has nothing to know, they don't know who they are. We recited from Surah Muhammad. فَإِذَا لَقِيْتُمُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَضَرْبَ الرِّقَابِ. Okay. They say, yeah, see, Allah says, if you meet a non-Muslim, just chop their head off. Oh, that sounds like. But if you read the all the way to the ayah, you will see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was giving a command to the Muslims when they were about to fight Quraysh. And Allah continues, حَتَّى إِذَا أَسْأَفْقَنْتُمُوهُمْ فَشُدُّوا الْوَثَاقَ فَإِمَّا مَنَّا بَعْدُ وَإِمَّا فِدَاءً حَتَّى تَضَعَ الْحَرْبُ أَوْزَارَهَا. In, subhanAllah, in each ayah, before it or after it, or in the page of it, Allah put down the context of why it was revealed. Al-Qur'an yufassiru ba'dahu ba'dah. SubhanAllah, the Qur'an explains itself. Allah was giving them a command that when you are in war, and then you meet the armed enemy. Question. Let me tell you now, let's see how it's the ignorance that they have, and the ignorance of us all they hope to see, that's why they misuse it. Question. Give me some of the major battles that Muslims fought. Major battle. First one. Badr. How many Muslims were participating in Badr? About 315, right? How many of Quraysh? About 1,000, three times the number, correct? Were the Muslims capable of just meeting them and striking their necks? No. Then who won Badr? How did the Muslims win Badr? Allah said, I sent 1,000 angels to fight the battle. 1,000 angels. Muslims could not kill many of them at all. Right? Uhud. Second major battle. Muslims were about 600 because somebody convinced the 900 some should go back. And Quraysh was about 3,000. Did Muslims win that battle?
No.
Did they kill too many of Quraysh? So then, we have to ask, in all these battles, did the Muslims just go and find non-Muslims and execute them? In the history of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Muslims just walk and find somebody who's not a Muslim and execute them? Did we find out? Were there non-Muslims living in Medina? Many, right? Maybe a couple of thousand. Did the Muslims chop their heads when they met them? Never. They know this. That never in the history of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam you just meet a non-Muslim and you chop their heads. Even when Allah gives a command to fight, subhanAllah, listen to this. In At-Tawbah, there is an ayah that they like to use. They call it the verse of the sword. I don't know why they call it the verse of the sword. It says, فَإِذَا سَلَخَ الْأَشْهُرُ الْحُمْ فَاقْتُلُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُمُوهُمْ وَخُذُوهُمْ وَاحْصُرُوهُمْ وَاقْعُدُوا لَهُمْ كُلَّ مَرْصَدٍ. When Allah gave the command that the treaties with Quraysh or all those pagan tribes are over, the Muslims should pursue them because they've been plotting wars against Islam even after Fatih Mecca. So Allah says, that's it. Look what Allah says, even while you have a war. Next ayah, fast forward. وَإِنْ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ اسْتَجَارَكْ فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ كَلَامَ اللَّهِ ثُمَّ أَبْلِغْهُ مَأْمَنَ. Allah says, if one mushrik seeks your assistance, this is a time of war, and an area could be under warfare. If one mushrik comes and seeks your assistance, what are you supposed to do? Chop their head?
No.
فَأَجِرْهُ حَتَّى يَسْمَعَ. You should assist that person so that they can listen to the word of Allah. And what should you do at the end of your assistance? ثُمَّ أَبْلِغُهُ مَأْمَنَ. Allah says you should make that person live safely. An innocent person who has nothing to do with your war, you are supposed to protect them, help them, and give them safe passage. Do they live by these verses, by the way? Don't they kidnap aid workers, people coming to help? In Syria, they kidnap aid workers, they kidnap doctors, they kidnap humanitarian workers and execute them. Now, when you look at the evil acts, do they reflect anything in Quran? Absolutely not. Did not Allah leave an ayah so clear, so unequivocal, that has no exception? What did Allah say in Al-Ma'idah? مِنْ أَجْلِ ذَلِكَ كَتَبْنَا عَلَى بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ أَنَّهُ مَنْ قَتَلَ نَفْسًا بِغَيْرِ نَفْسٍ أَوْ فَسَادٍ فِي الْأَرْضِ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَتَلَ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Allah says, if you kill an innocent person, or you spread this type of corruption of killing, if you kill one, it's like you kill everybody. If you can kill an innocent person, a woman, a child walking in the street, you can kill every human being. It goes to show you the level of depravity a human being will have. That you have no rahmah in your heart to kill a child through an improvised explosive device, planting bombs in the markets of the Muslims, blowing up bombs in Masajid. Don't they do that? Even in Saudi Arabia, they've blown up nearly five Masajid. Saudi court. How many of you are 30 years or older? 30 and above. Raise your hand if you're 30 and above. MashaAllah. And some of you are shy. Don't worry. Gray is 30. In Jannah, everybody's the same age, inshallah, 33 years old. Do you know that in Mecca, a group of such people, they took over the haram with guns? They killed hundreds of people through the siege. The haram, the house of Allah, which Allah does not want any bloodshed in his house. That's why he said, وَقَاتِلُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ وَلَا تَعْتَدُوا وَلَا تُقَاتِلُوهُمْ عِنْدَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. Allah revealed this ayah telling the Muslims, when you go to Fath Makkah, do not fight anyone except those who want to fight. Don't fight them in Masjid al-Haram unless they initiate. How can a group of Muslims take guns into Makkah? When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said this, it goes to show you the ignorance. لا يحل لامرئ مسلم يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر أن يحمل بمكة السلاح. If you believe in Allah and the Day of Judgment, you do not carry a weapon in Mecca. Why? It's the holiest place on earth. You know how they brought guns into Mecca? They pretended they bring in dead bodies for Salat al-Janazah. They carried the biers and they had weapons on top of it. They brought it in this way. After Salat al-Fajr, they took over the masjid. What would make somebody do? Violate the sanctity of Allah's house.
What year?
1979. Yes, Juhayman al-Utaybi. This guy is so righteous. He convinced a group of people, a couple of hundred, to take over Mecca and he will bring peace to the world. These grandiose ideas they all have. One thing they all have in common, they use violence. How come Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was able to spread Islam through Sulh al-Hudaybiyah more so than through jihad? Jihad, Allah, or fighting, qital, is there to do what? To stop aggression and oppression when it reaches an intolerable level. That's it. Because only through peace people can listen to the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they misuse the Quran the way they want to. They know that Allah said, you cannot kill an innocent person. Abada. Now they want an excuse for that. They say, well, we're retaliating, right? And that's good enough. So if they kill, so saying if the West kills Muslim women, children, people, then we can indiscriminately kill them too. Question. Have you ever seen, how many times were Muslims killed in Mecca? A few Muslims. Were they not killed before? Who were the first Muslims that were killed in Mecca? Ammar's. His father, Ammar's, was spared. His mother, Sulayya. Subhanallah, she is one of the first shuhada, a woman, Sulayya. They were killed for just believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Did the Muslims retaliate for that killing?
No.
They were prevented to even retaliate in that kind. When they went to Al-Madinah, did they immediately retaliate for all these killings? No. Question. In Uhud, the Muslims suffered a major setback that resulted in the death of somebody special in Islam. Who is that somebody?
Hamza.
Hamza, right? Hamza is who? The uncle of Prophet Muhammad, Sayyid al-Shuhada. He is the head of all Shuhada in Islam. he was the first to stand to want to fight for Islam. He was brave to fight. Did he fight anybody in Mecca? No, because Allah said no fighting. When, how did Hamza die? He was killed by another person. Wahshi, right? It was an Abyssinian slave that was hired by Hind. He was a very skillful. He was very skillful with the javelin, you know, a spear. And during the fighting, he targeted him, and then he killed Hamza. What did he do after killing Hamza? What did Hind want him to do after killing Hamza? Take his liver out, mutilate the body, and it grieved Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Did the Muslims ever mutilate anybody after that? In fact, here's Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's instructions when you fight. He says, "Ughzu wa la tawallu wa la tabdiru wa la tamthuru wa la taqtulu walida wa la ashab as-sawami." One hadith. He said, when you fight for the sake of Allah, do not commit treachery. Do not steal from the booty. Do not mutilate anyone. There are some things are forbidden in Islam. You can't say, oh, because somebody do this, I'm going to do it too. Because Allah made it for you. Why? Because the Muslims establish morality in combat. There is no people ever in the history of this world that had an army that does not pillage, that does not burn, that does not destroy, that does not mutilate, that does not do all of that. Only the Muslims, when they fight you, they fight so that you can stop fighting. Hatta la takuna fitna. Allahu Akbar. The Muslims are the only ones who fight, not to what? Just to mutilate people. And the Muslims are the first who, when they took prisoners of war, they fed them and they made them ride their camels. Morality, even in combat. No army has morality. They will drop 2,000-pound bombs, cluster bombs, nuclear bombs, and it will just destroy everything. And call them collateral damage. Islam does not approve of that. Weapons of mass destruction in Islam are not appropriate. Allah wants only hand-to-hand combat. Why? It minimizes casualties. Minimizes casualties. Only in Islam. They know this. They know that it's not appropriate in Islam. And yet, time and time again, they will pick this ayah, they will pick that ayah, just part of the ayah, and then they'll use it. They call it vengeance. Was Prophet ﷺ fighting because of revenge? He suffered the most. They tried to kill him many times. They have already persecuted him many times in Mecca. He wasn't fighting. So what happened when the Muslims took over Mecca now? How many people did they slaughter? Was there even a slaughter in Mecca? Fatih Mecca. Guess what people started saying, Quraysh. They started saying, oh, son of our such and such and such. What are you going to do to us now? Now that you're in charge, you have power, you have victory. Fatih Mecca. Subhanallah. Rasulullah looked at him and says, idhabu fa antum al-tulaqa. He says, go, you're released today. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the first leader of any group of human beings that showed the most graceful magnanimity. To be magnanimous is to pardon people even if they've wronged you. Is to show them mercy when you can exact revenge. Do you know of any ruler, any military general that was this merciful in the history of humanity? Who, after you've been persecuted, harmed by a group of people, you show them this kind of mercy? In any history, have you read any history?
One of the emirs of the army said, this is the day we are going to revenge. And the Prophet ﷺ removed him from power.
Like this. Because it's not about revenge. Revenge is what leads to bloodshed. That we Muslims have a character that is unique, even while fighting, even while you look at the enemy. Like in one of the battles, a Muslim, right? He overcame and overpowered one of the enemy, and he wanted to kill him, and the enemy said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. What did that Muslim do? He killed him. What happened when the news reached Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He was extremely upset. He said, why did you kill him? He said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah to save his neck from my sword. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, were you in his heart when he said it? Can you imagine you're fighting, you're dueling somebody, you're just about to kill him as a Muslim, you have to stop if the conditions change? Ali ibn Abi Talib was fighting somebody. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, he was a skillful fighter. Nobody has defeated him at any time. Allahu Akbar. He disarmed the man, and just before he went to kill the man spat at him. And then he stopped. The man said, why don't you kill me? He said, when I was fighting you, I was fighting you for the sake of Allah. When you spat at me, you angered me, and I was going to fight you for my own sake. So I didn't kill you. Allahu Akbar. This is Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu. He understood from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you don't fight for your own personal feeling. Can you imagine stopping while you're fighting somebody? None of us have this type of control. It's not possible. He said, no, I'm not going to kill you for my sake. It's okay. Because he went through with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to learn how to be disciplined. When you see people adulterating Quran, you and I should be very concerned. When they take Quranic ayat, a little nasheed, and a couple of nice Hollywood style movies, you know, and they always use young men calling other young men to come. Have young men, have you seen the YouTube videos yet? Very nicely done, right? They make it look like it's fun. They're walking with their black long hair, holding black flags. They look like they just came out of the game Call of Duty, right? These are young, ignorant, idle men who have something to prove. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam described them at his time. One time Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was dividing the spoils of war. And then a man of Badr walked up. Imagine this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving the fighters spoils of war. A man came up and said this. Listen to what this man said. Who's a doctor in here? Who's a doctor? Physician. When you hear what I'm about to tell you, it might cause everybody's blood pressure to go up. So get ready to resuscitate whoever falls down. This man walked up to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He doesn't even use respect. He said, Ya Muhammad, ittaqillah wa a'lin fil qisma. He said, O Muhammad, fear Allah and be just when you give out this booty. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, who will be just if I am not? Who will fear Allah if I don't fear Allah? This is what this man said. The companions wanted to kill him immediately. How can somebody say to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ittaqillah? He says, no, leave him. He said, there will be people that come after him that have the following characteristics. That they are very young in age, the way he, you know, Hudatha was done. And then he says, Sufaha'ul Ahlam, they are very foolish in their ideas. These people will come, if they recite Quran, you will feel that your Quran doesn't even come close. When you see them worshipping, you're going to think that they're more superior than you. But the Quran they recite does not even cross their throat. Look at this description. They recite Quran, it doesn't even cross their throat. Meaning, the meaning isn't even there. They just say. They will leave this deen like if you shot an arrow on a deer, the arrow pierced the deer gun. Yabukuna min al-Islam. This is how fast they come out of Islam. He described them this way. They will be young, foolish. They think they are ultra religious. They're holier than everybody else. And they will have no rahmah in their hearts, he said, in another hadith. And in another hadith, he called them the dogs of hell. You see some people act that way today. clear description from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is proof that he's a prophet because he said it 1400 plus years ago. And we have lived to see it. We have lived to see it. They use Quran nicely. When you hear them sound, you say, wow, man, this mashallah sounds good. And yet, they don't live by the Quran at all. They only pick the verses they like to hear. Wallahi, brothers and sisters, there are no verses in Quran you should fear. All the verses of jihad, they have a context. And inshallah, in our next session, I want to just demonstrate for you simply how you can see the context of an ayah within itself. So that way you know not to take the ayah out of its context. Now, someone is going to say that, well, the Quran is supposed to be till the end of time. That is true. If some ayat are historical, how do we live by them in the future? Doesn't make the Quran obsolete if it's only for that time. The Quran will last for all time. When you try to take an ayah from 1400 years ago and apply it in 2015, you have to take the entire ayah and its context and its reason for revelation, and then try to apply it as well. For example, in Quran, some ayat have been abrogated, okay? They no longer apply, of course, because it was graduality prohibition. Alcohol was khamr forbidden in the very beginning of Islam? No. When did Allah ban alcohol? In Medina, correct? Some people drank in Mecca. And Allah revealed ayat taking people slowly from substance abuse to being sober. So you cannot say today, brother, it's halal for me to drink alcohol as long as I don't come to the masjid. لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى. You can't just implement that ayah. Why? Because it's a superseding ayah that says إنما الخمر والميسر والأنصار والأزلام رجس من عمل الشيطان فاجتنبوه. Allah has revealed a final verse that now says alcohol is not. It's not allowed. It's prohibited. This hikmah. That is why Allah had to taught His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam how to apply Quran, so that way we learn from who? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You just don't say, "Hey, I'm going to take the Mus'haf. I'm going to become my own sheikh." A lot of these people that join ISIS and all of this, they are young people who never used to practice Islam at all. Can you imagine that? They never used to. You know, the Paris attackers, one of them was described this way, that they were never seen, non-Muslims saying, they never practiced it, we've never seen them even read their book. We just noticed 1 month prior, they started becoming religious. And yet now, what's the first thing young people do when they're religious? Is what? Oh, I'm going to fight jihad. Why in 13 years in Mecca, Allah told them, there is no fighting for anybody? Because you need discipline. You need iman first. By emotion, you're going to do things. People are emotional. A lot of them don't even know. Islam for dummies is the most read book among them. You know, one of the captives, the French journalist, he said they kept me for a couple of months. All throughout that time, I didn't see them read the Quran. Can you imagine a non-Muslim testifying to how they are? And one of them will go out to police people with his gun, confiscating cigarettes and stuff. Guess what he does with the cigarette? He's smoking it at home. Do you know that some of them are online watching porn?
Yes, and they hate women.
Yes? No. Oh, well, if you watch porn all day, I mean, at least you're going to need to do something about it. These people are dehumanizing themselves. They're not righteous people. They pretend to be righteous. The Quran that they recite, by the way, majority of them don't even know how to read Quran. There's a few of them that can read Quran. These are the people that you see on TV claiming to be fighting jihad for the sake of Allah, and they violate every law that Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam laid upon jihad. This is very serious. We need to deal with it. How do we deal with it? We need to talk about all the ayat of jihad, all the ahadith that explain it. We need to educate every young person here That way you don't go to the internet and look at any of these silly videos. Because, brothers and sisters, we still have a problem, like you see in California. For somebody who used to come to the masjid, self-radicalizes, and then goes and commits an unspeakable act against people. And alhamdulillah, the non-Muslim neighbors of that masjid said it's a peaceful place, they were never radicalized in that masjid. Non-Muslims said that. Even the city, our law enforcement chief said, I know this masjid, they never learned it from this masjid. Even people testify that the Muslim community in San Bernardino had nothing to do with this. What I'm asking us all to do is to work together to identify when somebody seems to be having a challenge in society. I am saying to all young men, this is my promise to all of you, no matter how young you are, if you have a question about your deen, you feel uneasy about something in Islam, please come to me. I will never turn you into the authorities, ever. You're my brother, first of all. If you need help and information, my job is to give you help and information. I can sit down one-on-one and explain to you anything you want to know about you have, whether you should or should not. I want you to take this measure today. You are not allowed to engage in this violent extremism in America, in France, anywhere, including Syria. Because some of these groups, they kill who? Other Muslims. That's what they're doing. So they bring a young man from the West who doesn't know what's going on. When you land, one group says, join us, we brought you here. And oh, by the way, we're going to go attack the other group. And then you're like, what? And you end up attacking another Muslim group. You get killed or you kill somebody. You start to lose your humanity. You start to lose the rahmah in your heart. Then you just become a killer. That's what they're trying to do. You're not allowed to leave America, leave your parents, and go anywhere without their permission. You're not allowed to attack anyone in America, Muslim or non-Muslim. It is haram in Islam. Completely, it is haram. Don't listen to those people and their message of violence has no place in Islam. Any of you, young or old, if you have anything, come and approach us. Allah. I will sit one-on-one with you until, and I'm sure Allah will convince you, whatever is bothering you, the problem is not anything but within yourself, and that the solution is not to just go kill innocent people. Islam is the religion that leads to peace. Documented in history. We've seen the history of Islam. Islam has saved the lives of so many people in war. Because the objective of jihad is just to make the aggressive party stop fighting. وَقَاتِلُوهُمْ حَتَّى لَا تَكُونَ فِتْنَةً وَيَكُونَ الدِّينُ لِلَّهِ. That's the only objective of that. What about da'wah? 13 years in Mecca, da'wah. Many more years in Al-Madinah. They don't do da'wah. They don't do da'wah. They only spread fitna. And so therefore, young men, young women, we all need to learn this deen. Do not go to Sheikh Google and Imam YouTube. I'm very serious. That's not where you learn. Why did Allah designate a teacher for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Jibreel, to teach him this deen, to teach him Quran? Why did all the Sahaba learn Quran from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by listening to its recitation, listening to its interpretation and explanation, and watching the application, and then transmitted it to us? Everything has been documented. Alhamdulillah. We have to take the same methodology to learn the deen. Alhamdulillah, mashallah, young men coming to the masjid, learning your deen. This is your Islam 101. Don't please join the College of Violent Extremism. You should focus coming to this masjid, learning as much as you can, participating in community activities, be engaged in outreach and dawah activities. You can change America by being a Muslim. In and out, that's all you have to be. People will look at you and say, I would like to be like you. I'm not Muslim. That is how Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam changed many people by his behavior, not by his sword. We know this. It's history. SubhanAllah. So, my dear respected brothers and sisters, we condemn the acts of violence by the violent extremists. We condemn those who come to TV to say Muslims are the enemy and that they should ban Muslims from coming in this country. We condemn that as well. We always condemn when innocent life is taken, whether it happens in full state or it happens in America or anywhere in the globe, because Muslims believe that all human life is sacred. No one should take anybody's life wrongfully. There's a lot of wars, there's a lot of politics happening in the world. We know that. We know that there's foreign policy elements here and there that actually helps this spread. We know that. But the solution is not to now start causing acts of terrorism, but rather for us to first improve ourselves, improve our neighbors, and if everybody changes themselves, what will Allah do about change? In Allah la yughayyiru ma biqawmin hatta yughayyiru ma bi anfusihim. If we all change ourselves in America, look how Allah says the ripple effect, bottom, top. If all Muslims all over the world change themselves, they improve themselves, what would Allah do to our condition? Allah says, I will change your condition. It's because we all rotten on the inside, so what the condition is unhealthy. Allah says, I can change it. And He will change it in time, but you have to have sabr. Everybody, I'm asking you, learn your deen. Connect with the Qur'an. Learn how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam implemented it. You'll see that he did not do any of these things. We ask Allah to bring peace all over the Muslim world. We ask Allah to protect the Muslims in Syria, in Palestine, in Iraq, Afghanistan, Kashmir, Pakistan, Nigeria, Somalia, Kenya, all over the world. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make all the violence in the world stop. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put a drop of rahmah in the heart of humanity, that we stop killing each other. There are 30,000 people killed in America every year by gun violence. 30,000. More so than any war zone. We ask Allah to stop that as well. We ask Allah to guide our public service, that they not make Islam the enemy, but have learned to see that Islam is the hope. We ask Allah one day to make Islam the only religion in this world, so that way there will be only peace and fighting. And by the way, when Islam is the dominant religion and others are not, there is peace for everyone, because Jews and Christians live peacefully amongst Muslims, documented history. We ask Allah to send back all the young men home who are lost out there killing people without a cause. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واصرف عنا برحمتك شر ما قضيت فإنك تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وانصر الإسلام والمسلمين واغفر لجميع موتى المسلمين يا عزيز يا كريم سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وجزاكم الله خيرا بارك الله فيكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Yeah, really.